me to be behind Benny's presentation. But anyhow, I will try to do my best. So my name is Werner Verbruggen. I'm also Belgian, so I will not repeat the words that Benny did about Belgium. So I fully support him, what he's told about Belgium. So that's one point. I was a colleague of him for, now 6 years ago, because I'm now 6 years working at Europol as a so-called senior specialist. So I was also a Belgian policeman. I just tell I was, because the Belgian police put me on pension since last month. So on that side, I'm quite happy, but I still can work, I think, till 2019 at Europol. So no problem for me. Anyhow, I will try to cover in my presentation today some problems which we are facing about environmental effects purely on synthetic drugs. Mainly, this is my point. Just to show you a little bit about my organization, Europol. I don't know if there are a lot of people in the room which are familiar with Europol, but Europol is so Europol police. We are coordinating, let me say, or trying to coordinate the police activities in Europol amongst all police forces. There's a pointer. I'm sitting in this part, serious organized crime. I will go on. So this is our serious organized crime organigram, and we are sitting in this focal point. Where's my pointer here? So our focal point is synergy. So synergy is related to synthetic drugs. So we are, in fact, in the past we were a separate kind of department, but anytime when we got a new head of area, a new head of business, they will change the organigram. So every time when we have a new manager, they reinvent, let me say, the wheel. And a few years ago, they split us. All focal points of drugs were splitted. Now they put us again together. So yeah, I don't know what will happen in a few years. But anyhow, now we are getting together again, so we can talk again with colleagues from cocaine, heroin, and cannabis. So synergy, what are we doing in synergy? We are trying to tackle the whole problem of synthetic drugs from the beginning till the end. And therefore, I like to use this, just a small drawing, because synthetic drugs is, it's not one single thing, it's like a timeline. So Benny also referred a little bit in his presentation, but if you are synthetic drugs, you have different things. So you need to find places to produce synthetic drugs. You need chemicals, you need precursors, which are the essential chemicals. Without those essential chemicals, you cannot produce your synthetic drugs. You need equipment. You need a lot of equipment to produce drugs. It's not like cannabis, it's like a plant. You have a plant and it will grow and you have your product. No, for synthetic drugs, you need material, equipment. So you need to buy it. If you have your equipment, you need people to cook, so what we call the cooks. You need people with knowledge to cook synthetic drugs. I can't imagine that a lot of people here in this room can cook amphetamine or can cook ecstasy. You need to know how to do it. You have cooks. You have people who are taking care of the dumping, and this will be my subject of my presentation. People are taking care of the dumping because cooking amphetamine, cooking ecstasy generates, I have to watch out here that I don't fall down, generates a lot of waste. So they have to do something with the waste. In the cooking process for ecstasy, for instance, you need to make tablets. Benny showed you a nice picture of tablets. So you need people who are making tablets. You need people who are selling things on the street. So for synthetic drugs, everything is in separated specialities. And the people who are dealing with the chemicals and with the precursors, they don't have contact with the cooks. Those people don't have contacts who are taking care of the dumping. So everybody has his own specialty. Okay, it's one organized crime organization, but still everybody has his own specialty. And I will try to cover this specialty of dumping, because they have some, yeah, more or less specialized techniques to try to get rid of their waste. So that's what we have to cover in our focal point. Don't think that I'm working in a European police organization, that our unit is big. We have to do this kind of work with only, let me think now, 5 people. That's it. We have 3 specialists for the time being, and we have 2 analysts. Analysts means that those people are dealing with operational data. They have to connect cases with each other. Okay. Good. I will just a few general statements about other environmental problems caused by other drugs. And you can see it's an overlooked and ignored aspect. For cutting the rainforests, for the planting of coca fields, deforestation for opium fields, also for growing marijuana, Benny showed it. And then you see the manufacture of all synthetic and semi-synthetic drugs makes an impact on the environment. Illegal drug production contributes to deforestation, reduced biodiversity, increased erosion, air pollution, the global climate change. So there are some amounts of methane, CO2, and whatsoever. Just an example. It's figures we took over from, I think, United Nations. But if you can see, I will not read everything, but if you see that at the conclusion, the consumption of 1 gram of cocaine implies the destruction of 4 square meters of the rainforest. So it's huge. If you compare it, if you go then on a global scale, it's really huge. The same if you talk about the chemicals, what we are using. For 1 kilo of cocaine base, you need 3 liters of concentrated sulfuric acid, calcium carbonate, 10 kilo, 80 liters of kerosene, 200 grams of potassium permanganate, 1 liter of concentrated ammonia. So all these chemicals are used only for the produce of 1 kilo of cocaine. So all those chemicals need to be dumped somewhere. And this causes, of course, a huge problem. Same here for opium. What do you need? 1 hectare opium field requires the cleaning of the clearing of 2.5 hectares of forest. If we talk about methamphetamine, a kilo, methamphetamine results also in 10 to 12 kilos of hazardous waste. Okay, I will skip this one. Production process. In fact, what we see a lot, what is, let me say, the general production processes in Europe for amphetamine and also for ecstasy, two main synthesizers, we call them is the Leuchart synthesis. It's based on the BMK, benzylmethylketone, P2P, a lot of different synonyms for the same precursor. And the second method, and this one is used for the MDMA production, the ecstasy production. We have the reductive amination production synthesis, where they're using hydrogen gas, platinum oxide. You can use aluminium amalgam, which is a very, very dirty method of making synthetic drugs, and then you have the cold method where they will use sodium borohydride, but I will come back on that. Very specific to that is it's also something which is a bit related to the problem we have in Belgium and the Netherlands. As Benny told, Belgium is a small country, let me think it's not bigger than this. And then you have here on top, you have the Netherlands like this, a bit bigger. And the main problems for synthetic drugs are related on this side, on this border side. So this is the real problematic area for synthetic drugs, even on European level, because the most of the labs are situated in this area. And why? Because they are playing with the borders. And you have to know that, for instance, the synthesis of Leuchart is a multi-step synthesis. So it's not like you put all chemicals in one pot, you just cook it, and at the end you have your end product. No, you have to do different steps. If you start your synthesis of Leuchart, you need at least 7-8 steps before you have your end product, your amphetamine. And what they do, the criminals there are misusing or using the borders just to do step 1, step 2 here, step 3 and 4 there, 5 and 6 here. So they're spreading the risks of their labs, which means that if you seize a lab, you only take a part of a lab. So it's rarely nowadays that we find a complete lab from point step from step one till step seven till the end. And this, of course, means that we will find dump sites in the Netherlands which are belonging to a lab in Belgium and the other way around. So therefore, it's very crucial to have very good cooperation amongst the two countries. But as Benny also referred a little bit in his presentation, this cooperation is sometimes very, very far away, let me say. Okay? Just a kind of thing in between. You know that Belgium, we have a Flemish part and we have a French part. And now we are talking in Belgium to separate each other. So in future, this will be, I don't know, this go to France and we will take this and this will be Belgium. So Belgium will be a bit bigger in future. And then perhaps we can solve the problem if we are alone. Okay, Leucard, synthesis of Leucard, you can see it's a mess. They are cooking. You see if they are overcooking, something is happening. It can burn, it can explode if you do something wrong, if you put some chemical too less or too more, you can have problems. These are the different steps. You can see here how many steps you have for amphetamine, cooking amphetamine. Boiling stage, washing, boiling, separation, distillation, crystallization, filtration, drying. All those steps you need to do before you have your end product. And you can see here on this side which kind of different chemicals you need. BMK, formamide, formic acid, ether, hydrochloric acid, caustic soda, and so on. And on this side, and on this side, you can see the type of equipment you need. And this is all custom-made equipment. You cannot find this kind of material in a legal company. So you have also what we call facilitators. You need people who are specialized in making this kind of equipment. And also this kind of equipment, we will find this as waste. Reductive amination. Sorry, one back. Again here, custom-made apparatus. Very nice sometimes, very professionally made, but very, very dangerous. Certainly for policemen, if you need to dismantle a lab like this, very, very dangerous. You need to know what you're doing. It's not like you're just closing a valve or you disconnect something. By doing that, you can cause a major problem. Okay, here are the different steps for making MDMA. More or less the same. Some other material, some other equipment. And these are, of course, for the police, indications to identify the type of lab we are seizing. Reductive amination, don't think always in great terms or in great labs. No, a stupid refrigerator is enough to make MDMA, to make ecstasy. You only need a refrigerator, that's all. But it can also be a very dangerous refrigerator. This is this reductive amination with this aluminium amalgam, very, very dirty. They are working with aluminium foil, and it's a very dirty labs. We are happy that we don't see them that often, because this is really a challenge to clean up this kind of labs. The waste depends on the production methods used, the knowledge of the producer, the equipment which they are using. Everything depends on how they do it. The quality of the chemicals, are they working with recycled chemicals? Because they're also recycling chemicals. They can clean products. If they are using solvents, they can clean it and they can reuse it. But this, of course, will have result of your end product. These are the used chemicals, P2P, formamide, formic hydrochloric, sulfuric acid, acetone, methanol. And you can see here the amount of waste which is produced. If you produce 1 kilo of amphetamine, you will have between 20 to 30 kilo of waste. It's a lot. The same for the cold method. If you are using the cold method, 1 kilo of MDMA, 1 kilo of ecstasy, will produce 6 to 10 kilos of dangerous toxic waste. This is a calculation which we made for, based on figures we got from the Dutch police. So if you calculate from what I just showed you, the previous slide, that you have 20 to 30 kilo of liters of waste from amphetamine and you have 6 to 10 for MDMA, If you then calculate for the amount of amphetamine which was seized in 2006, so you had 1,800 kilos of amphetamine seized in the Netherlands, which if you then calculate with this amount, then you will have between 36 and 54,000 liters of waste. You take also the MDMA seized, then you have this kind of figures. So if you take it together, 50,000, 70,000 liters. And this is what we take in as a police figure, that we are seizing approximately 10% a year of the global, of the yearly production, let me say. So if you go then for 100%, then you have this amount of liters produced. So you have to do something with this amount of liters. So 780,000 liters of chemical waste, what shall you do with it? So you have to do something with it. And this is our problem. Okay, this is a slide which I took last week from I think it's a Dutch journal, a newspaper. We are seeing a very, let me say, increasing problem of waste. I will show it later. Why? Because they are using more and more other chemicals. And why is this? Because we have now a situation in Europe that mainly the, I can explain it quickly, that you have a lot of chemicals. So you need for amphetamine, you need this BMK. If you don't have this BMK, you cannot make your amphetamine. For ecstasy, you need your PMK. But all those chemicals are strict controlled. You cannot import, you cannot export, you cannot do any trade, you cannot do any possession. So it's almost impossible to import or to get this kind of chemicals. So what they do now, the producers, they are importing other products which are just before. So now they are importing a product which is called, or we call it APAN. It's alpha phenyl acetonitrile. And for this one, they're importing PMK glycidate, it's another product, which they convert into their BMK PMK. So there's a product which is now before the other products. Now this one is also on the list now, but there are other products which are before this one already. So they are, let me say, some production steps more than before. So the old situation was like in this one, you have your PMK, you make your product, and you have your waste. Now you have twice waste, because you need to produce your precursor, and then you have first waste, a second time waste, and then your end product. So that's one of the reasons why we have now twice as much waste as before. But this is also for us a challenge to identify those new chemicals. Ways of disposals, already showed by Benny, these are the most dangerous ones. I still have 5 minutes and a lot of slides to go, but I have a lot of photos. These are the dangerous ones. These are the ones which are, let me say, not very liked by fire brigade or neither by policemen. So if you come close to a small van like this and it explodes, yeah, you have a problem. These are the different ways, but I will come that there. These are most typical dumping sites, a stolen trailer full of chemicals, full of equipment, and all this trailer has to be, let me say, inventorized. You have to make your inventory, you have to make your technical investigation, and it's a lot of work. You see, it's full of chemicals, equipment, whatever. See the amounts in one trailer, and you have to handle it very careful. It's not like a normal job. Again, a trailer, stolen trailer. You need to have your protective clothing, your gas mask, whatever. So it's really a hard job to do, and you need to do it because this is the way how we can connect cases with each other. This is one of the roles also from the local police, or the police in the countries, but also from Europol. So we are also supporting member states by dismantling this kind of labs. So my background is also working in the lab intervention team in Belgium. I still do it now. I go sometimes to different member states to help them to dismantle illicit labs or dumping sites, whatever. But this is a job which we have to do, and I will show you later some slides how you can link. see examples of waste dumpings. This is a complete load of IBCs. This is intermediate bulk containers comes out of this trailer. So it's thousands of liters of waste. These are the specialized vans, so we already seized a lot of them. It's just a small van. They put just a barrel inside, a small pump, and whilst they are driving, they just pump out the chemicals. So very easy, but sufficient. And as Benny said, yeah, it's in the Belgium Netherlands, the weather is not that good. And if you have a day like it's a bit raining, it's yeah, nobody sees it. They just drive on the highway, just pump it out, and yeah, it's the way to get rid of the waste. And those are the people which are specialized. They are just paid to do this kind of things. They are paid per liter they are spreading out on the roads. Okay, again, another one, the same type. Stolen vans full of chemicals. These are the nasty ones, the ones which are exploding. This is what you can find in the morning, or some neighbors or some complaints come to the police. There was a fire in the forest. Please, can you have a look? And then you come there and then you see this. Yeah, and then you find out it's a dumping, chemical waste dumping. You find this. And here still you need to do your, or try to do a technical investigation. A way of dumping it, okay, this is a nice, one of the nice labs in Maastricht area, and everything, you see the pipes, goes down to the cellar, and then it was connected with the sewer system. And all waste went into the groundwater in the sewer system, so sometimes they are very, very clever. These are the typical ones. You find them in the morning, somewhere, in the middle of nowhere, and that's it. Waste, 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 liters, like this. They put it on fire, and then you can go and look for traces. And you see still the fumes, you can see the toxic products. Again, this was a huge one, big lorry. You can see even the, I don't know if you see it. It was still there, the fumes came out, really burned out, this lorry. The trees were almost gone on one side of the street. You can see here how it looked afterwards, so, and still you need to clean it up. Here you had even to clean the soil. And this intervention, I think it costed to the community like 78,000 euro just to clean up. You have to pay all different specialties who came there to clean up. System of the which you find in the streets, they put the waste. And then again, if you have intelligence that somebody is using this kind of modus operandi, yeah, you have to do the dirty job. Just go to the container park or recycling park and try to find out where are the jerrycans which they put in the system. So this is not a nice job. Typical ones, refrigerator. It's also waste. You can see how aggressive the chemicals are. So they're really, let me say, yeah, biting or eating the refrigerator. So and after a time, they have to change. But yeah, this is also a waste. Storage of chemicals. Sometimes they keep them for a long time and then they go for a lorry or a trailer, they put it in and they throw it away. The typical one, it's a dirty job for the police just to clean it up. One by one, you have to take it out. Try to find evidence. Here also, sometimes you need to walk a few hundreds of meters because they are floating in the water. In the woods. Everywhere. Again here, nice thing. Now I can show this are from the latest one. Same type here again also. See they just, yeah, most of the time they just hire a small van. They stop somewhere in the middle of the night, they push everything out, up, and they're gone. And that's it. The costs. These are the costs. What does it cost to clean up? Sand ground, 15 euro kilo. The clay, 181 euro kilo. And the average quantity, it's 800 kilo. So every dumping site we found, it's almost like 800 kilo. It's a lot, I can tell you. So what I told you, the one with the van the put on fire was, I said, 850,000 euros. So you have to, the cleaning cost, cleaning of the soil, municipality, you have to pay the fire brigade and other services. So it's a lot of money. So if you see, for the Netherlands, costs of cleaning was between 12,500 and 20,000 a dumping. If you see the amount of dumpings in 2013, the Dutch government had to pay between 1,900,000 and almost 3 million euros a year just to clean up the dumpings. Now, 2014, we will have like almost double of dumpings. So you can see up what the price will be. What, I, not you, Sweden, but people in the Netherlands have to pay just to clean up the dumpings. Measures. Well, I skip that one because I see I've almost took my time, but what I will tell now. Criminal organizations are using specialists. I told you already, they have specialists to dump. Self-production of precursors, I also told you, it's raising, so we will have more and more dumpings. They're using distillation machines, sometimes they're recycling. They put it also in the ground, it's possible. I will go to my last slides where I, this one, comparison. What can we do more or less to tackle the problem? We have to do a proper technical investigation. We have to do backtracking, what we call backtracking as policemen, to trace back from where chemicals are coming. We have to check the waste, because you can do some forensic analysis in your waste. You can say you can link the waste with each other. And if you can find an organization which was responsible for one waste, and you can prove it forensically that another waste dumping was the same, okay, just put it also in their file and they will pay it, or try to pay. So how can we link the dumpings, compare the chemicals, compare the amounts, the physical appearance, the labels, the text, the time, the traces, whatever? Yeah, we should do our work. Fingerprints are very important, DNA evidence, labels. So these are amounts. What I want to come is to this. Okay, you have barrels. On every barrel you have a UN number. This UN number is important to store at least in a database. We at Europol, we have a European database. It's called AELCS, European Illegal Laboratory Comparison System, where we put in data like this. So if we get from a member state's intelligence or information that a barrel was found with this UN number, we can perfectly say from Europol to the member state, yeah, this kind of barrel with the same number was found in this or that place. So it's an easy system, but you have to provide it. Labels, you find sometimes labels. A dumping site, you find a carton box with this kind of label. You can do something with this kind of label. You have a company, you have a name, you have a batch number. Just go to the company, ask who was buying this box with this product. This is a cutting product, okay, it's not that important, but this piece of information can be enough to identify, let me say, the responsible people for the dumping. The same here. You have a blue jerry can, there's a label, you have a company, you have a product number, you have a batch number, you have dates. Go to the company. At least we were asking, the in this case, the German authorities, please go to this company, try to find out who is buying this product. And then they came back with a nice answer. And then we could identify the people who are behind this dumping site. But you have to do it. It's very, very important. Same here, backtracking. A Polish company, you have a category number, you have a particle number, which can relate you to a person or another company. Okay, and just give it to the member states. Let them do the work. Marks. Most of the time, you don't see any labels on a jerrycan, but they're just marking with a small stift or a pen. They put something like this one, ZV, Zwavelzuur, sulfuric acid. They put it. Just put this kind of information in your system. It's a photo system, photo comparison. Sometimes you can put two photos next to each other and you can say, it's the same handwriting, so it must be the same source or the same people who are behind. So this is very, very important. Compare the waste. It's a dirty job. You have to take samples, some technical information, just some bacon and eggs. You have a date on it. Okay, if you find another place, the same packaging, the same, not the same bacon, but and you have the same date of production or fabrication or whatsoever, put it in a database. Try to link it with each other. These are small pieces of evidence. I cannot say it as much as possible, but DNA material, yeah, link it. If you find gloves, if you find cigarettes, if you find masks, send it to a forensic institute. Try to do it as much as possible. Is it risky? Is it dirty? I think it is. I will not, it's the end of my story, so I will not be in the place of this doggy. So sorry for the ladies in the room. But it's a risky business, and it is a very dirty business. Okay, thank you for your attention.